Welcome to Defender's Voice again. Today I would like to discuss this question. Why do atheists attack the book of Isaiah? Why do atheists attack the book of Isaiah? Many atheists of our time, Victor Stenger, Robert Wright, George Smith, Christopher Hitchens, Sam Harris, Bart Ehrman, Michael Ruse, Robert Banks, they focus their attacks on the book of Isaiah. There are 66 books in the Bible, but atheists concentrate their attacks on the book of Isaiah than many other books of the Bible. The book of Isaiah is a very important book for Christians. He was quoted more frequently in the New Testament than any other prophet. Isaiah prophesied so many things about coming Messiah. The New Testament writers described how those prophecies were fulfilled in the life of Lord Jesus Christ. Isaiah chapter 7 verse 14, Messiah would be born of a virgin. He would be called Emmanuel. Chapter 42 verses 1 and 4, Messiah would be anointed by the Holy Spirit of God. Chapter 40 verse 3, he would be preceded by a messenger. Chapter 9 verse 6, he would be the incarnation of very God. Chapter 11 verse 1, he would revive the Davidic dynasty. In chapter 28 verse 16, he would be the cornerstone. In chapter 41 verses 9 and 10, he would be betrayed by his very close friend. In chapter 42 verse 1, he would serve people through healing and preaching, and he emphasizes justice. In chapter 49 verse 4, he experiences discouragement in his ministry, but he preaches even to Gentiles. Chapter 50, he would go to Jerusalem to suffer, to be beaten and to spat upon. In chapter 53, he would be rejected by his own people. He would suffer while being innocent. In chapter 55, he would resurrect from the dead. In chapter 61, he would proclaim liberty and freedom to people under captivity. So you see, all these prophecies fulfilled in the life of Lord Jesus Christ at his first advent. You can't apply those prophecies to any other person. Name one human being beside Jesus of Nazareth to whom you can ascribe those prophecies. Isaiah has many other prophecies that will be fulfilled at his second coming. Chapter 4 verses 5 and 6, Messiah will defeat Israel's enemies. In chapter 26 verses 15 and 19, Israel will enjoy great prosperity and peace when Messiah comes back. In chapter 60 verses 1 to 5, Jerusalem will be center of God's earthly kingdom. In chapter 66, in Messiah's kingdom, there will be worldwide peace and harmony. In chapter 33, the knowledge of the Lord will prevail all over the world. In chapter 55, natural world will be restored and renewed. In chapter 60, Messiah will put an end to evil and suffering. In chapter 65, eternal kingdom of God follow Messiah's earthly rule. Those prophecies fill our hearts with joy and hope. The best is yet to come. Isaiah talks so much about the Messiah, we call it the fifth gospel. Isaiah became a constant source of faith, hope, joy, comfort, and inspiration to all people of God. Whenever Christians neglected the book of Isaiah, they committed serious and grievous mistakes. Last time I was in Israel, I went to see Ad Vashem in Jerusalem. It is the official memorial to the victims of the Holocaust. For over 4 hours, I walked around this great museum. It was tragic to see how so many Christians in Nazi Germany at best remained silent, and at worst they joined hands with accusers and persecutors of the Jewish people. In Ad Vashem, I saw how Christian anti-Semitism also played a role in the persecution of Jewish people. Ad Vashem, those Hebrew words were taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 56, verse 5. Even unto them will I give in my house and within my walls a place and a name. Isaiah asked his generation to search their hearts. Alan Eccleston wrote the book, The Night Sky of the Lord. He chronicled how generations of Christian anti-Semitism eased the work of Nazis when Hitler was building the concentration camps. Eccleston starts his book with a disturbing question from the book of Isaiah, chapter 21. What of the night? What of the night? But you see, there is also good news. People who studied the book of Isaiah carefully, they realized that God has not replaced the Jews with Christians. He did not substitute them with Christians, but united both Jews and Christians in one Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ. Many great Christian hymns were inspired by the book of Isaiah. For example, in Isaiah chapter 66, verse 12, we see the words that inspired Francis Ridley Havergal to compose the hymn, "Like a river glorious is God's perfect peace." Shalom, the peace of God. Jewish rabbis, they consider Isaiah second only to Moses among the prophets. Countless Jews came to Christ through seeing Jesus in Isaiah chapter 53. Handel composed the famous hymn Messiah based on the book of Isaiah. John Wesley, he founded Methodism with the inspiration from the book of Isaiah. Artists like Raphael borrowed their themes from the book of Isaiah. Martin Luther King Jr., in his famous "I Have a Dream" speech, said, "I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted, and every hill and mountain shall be made low. The rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together." He was quoting from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40. Isaiah predicted a day when all of God's children live together in peace without any animosity between them. The book of Isaiah also motivates us when we are in despair. Isaiah chapter 40 verse 30 states, "Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." When tragedies struck presidents, they take inspiration from the book of Isaiah. On February 1, 2003, Space Shuttle Columbia exploded as it re-entered its atmosphere. All seven crew members were killed. President Bush said in his eulogy, let me quote those words, "In the skies today, we saw destruction and tragedy. At farther than we can see, there is comfort and hope." In the words of the prophet Isaiah, "Lift your eyes and look to the heavens, who created all these. He who brings out the starry hosts one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. The same creator who names the stars also knows the names of the seven souls we mourn today. The crew of the Shuttle Columbia did not return safely to earth. Yet we can pray that all are safely home." That summarizes the message of this book. God, who created the stars, also created us. He who names the stars also knows the names of his children. At their appointed time, God calls his children home. Now, God, who knows the stars, also knows you personally. Atheists mock such belief. They view human beings as unplanned products of stardust out of the cold, careless cosmos. Voyager 1 is the farthest human object from the Earth. It was sent into space to communicate to extraterrestrials. It was launched in 1977 and it already left solar system. Now it is in interstellar space. Carlos Sagan made arrangements so that Voyager 1 would take some photographs of planet Earth as it travels in the space. On February 14, 1990, Voyager 1 sent some images of the Earth from a distance of 4 billion miles. Imagine that, taking a photograph of Earth from 4 billion miles away. That is what Voyager 1 did. Carl Sagan was so enthralled by those photographs, and the naturalistic philosopher in him spoke out. Listen to his words. "Look again at that dot. That's here, that's home, that's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager. Every hero and coward, every creator and destroyer of civilization, every king and peasant, every young couple in love, every mother and father, hopeful child, inventor and explorer, every teacher of morals, every corrupt politician, every superstar, every supreme leader, every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, and a mote of dust suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel and the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves." But look now to what the book of Isaiah is saying. The book of Isaiah, chapter 41, verse 14. Here God says, "Fear not, thou worm Jacob. You men of Israel, I will help you, declares the Lord, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel." God is saying, "Thou worm Jacob, I know you are insignificant. I know you are unremarkable, yet I loved you, and I want to help you." On one hand, we have Carl Sagan's of this world who are baffled by these images from the space. They say, our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe are challenged by this point of pale light. Our imagined self-importance. But God says, your self-importance is not imagined, it is real. I created you in my image. Atheists say it is the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe. God says it is not a delusion. Human beings are the crown of my creation. Atheists say, in our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. But the book of Isaiah refutes such a view. God wants to save humanity from itself. God wants to help. Isaiah 41:14, God is saying the same thing. Fear not, the worm, Jacob, you men of Israel, I will help you, declares the Lord, your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. So you see, atheists like Carl Sagan, they come with an anti-supernatural bias. In their view, human beings are just an accident on this pale blue dot floating in a mindless cosmos. They attack the book of Isaiah because they take offense at the idea that there is a God who cares for human beings. There is a God who gave a privileged status to human beings. We all believe in presuppositions. Even atheists, they come with presuppositions, the a priori ideas. They say, because there is no God, religion is a human invention. History is at the mercy of climate change. There is no meaning to human life. There is no purpose to human history. Human species is an accident. And you and I are accidents. The book of Isaiah contradicts such views. It introduces a God. A God who is one. Now, atheists say that humanity invented God. It started with polytheism. They say Jews originally believed in many gods, but after their Babylonian exile, they became monotheists. The book of Isaiah talks about a God who is one. Atheists are not afraid of Greek pantheon. They are not afraid of pantheism. Monotheism troubles them. They are scared of a supreme God who is one. Isaiah 45:22 says, look unto me and be saved, all the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. A God who rules the universe. Atheists believe that universe accidentally produced human beings and human beings made gods for their own convenience. It is not God who made humans in his image. It is humans who made gods in their own image. So universe made God. It's not the other way around. Human mind and the human brain are products of evolution. There was one big stone called Earth formed 4 billion years ago. Give time, out of that one big stone come elephants and eels. Give time, out of that big stone come butterflies and whales. Give time, out of that big stone come dolphins and dogs. Give time, out of that big stone great minds like Newton's and Einstein's will come out. What a baloney. In their worldview, time and matter and space do all the miracles of nature. They don't need any intelligence to make intelligent beings. Blind chance can make wonders. They can't stand the possibility of an intelligent being as our creator. But the book of Isaiah refutes that view. It talks about a creator who created everything in this universe. He is the creator, but he separates himself from his creation. Isaiah 55 verses 8 and 9, we read, for my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Atheists have no problem with small gods of ancient tribes. They are easy to dismiss. Osiris and Horus and Amun-Ra, Anubis, they all vanished into history. But this God is eternal. In Isaiah chapter 25, verse 8, we read these words. He will swallow up death in victory, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from off all faces. For atheists, death terminates all existence. There is no existence beyond the grave. But Isaiah talks about a God who swallows up death in victory. A God who will destroy death forever. Zeus and Athena, Apollo, Demeter, Poseidon, Hermes, and Artemis, the Olympian gods, are not eternal. They come and vanish. But Isaiah talks about a God who is eternal and unique. Isaiah 45, verse 25, God says, "To whom then will ye liken me, or shall I be equal, says the Holy One." Isaiah talks about a God who is the creator of the universe. If you believe that God, it is easy to believe in miracles. Atheists refuse to believe in that God, and not surprisingly, they deny the miracles. The book of Isaiah talks about an angel killing 185,000 Assyrian soldiers during the siege of Jerusalem. Atheists say, "Oh, what a funny fairy tale. No such thing could happen." But let me give you an example. Let us say a dad took his son to a shopping mall. And it's his son's birthday. And the dad wanted to buy a great gift for his son. Dad said, "Son, go ahead and choose whatever you want, and I will buy it for you." Son is walking in the shopping mall. He wants to buy a nice computer, but thought within himself, "Oh, my dad might think it is a bit expensive." Then he saw a BMW car, and then thought within himself, "It is impossible. My dad would never buy such an expensive gift for me." Then the dad said, "Son, I can read your thoughts. Don't worry about how expensive it is. If you like it, take it. I will buy the entire mall for you if you want." The son was so shocked. He almost shouted at his dad, "Dad, are you kidding? The shopping mall might cost like $200 million. How can you buy that?" Then the dad said, "Son, what is my name?" The son said, "Bill Gates." And dad said, "Bill Gates, right? I am the richest man in the world. My net worth is like $75 billion. I can buy a $200 million shopping mall for you. It's not a big deal for me." So you got my point. $200 million gift would be unthinkable for us, but not for Bill Gates. In the same way, miracles are impossible for our natural mind, but not for the creator of the universe. Atheists mock the miracles in the Bible. "Oh, Israelites walked through dry ground in the Red Sea. They walked through dry ground in River Jordan. God sending food from sky when they were in the wilderness." Atheists mock the idea of miracles. A donkey talking to one prophet, a whale swallowing another prophet, and this prophet lives in its belly for 3 days. Three young Hebrew men can survive a fiery furnace. Water can turn into blood. Water can turn into wine. What a bunch of fairy tales. If you tell them as stories of fiction, we have no problem. But as facts of history, they are not possible at all. You see, they rule out miracles because they have a prior commitment to a universe without a creator God. They rule out miracles because they have a prior commitment to naturalism. But Isaiah talks about a God who is the creator of the universe. If you believe in that God, it is not difficult to believe that this God sent an angel who massacred 185,000 soldiers when Sennacherib invaded Jerusalem. Then a God who is holy. Isaiah talks about a God who is holy. The Holy One of Israel. You will find this name 24 times in this book. Now, atheists say, "We have corruption in the church. And that is true. We have bishops abusing children. We have ministers keeping mistresses. We have pastors filling their pockets using the name of God. Atheists denounce this corruption in Christianity. But that's the whole point of the Bible. In his book, God and New Atheism, John F. Hart wrote these words, I quote, "It would be hard to find in all the annals of atheism any more substantive denunciation of religious abuse than that memorialized in the words of Amos, Hosea, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Micah, and their ilk throughout the ages." What was Isaiah doing in his day? He was exposing the corruption in the religion of his day. What was Jeremiah doing? He was exposing the corruption in the religion of his day. What was Jesus doing? He was exposing the corruption in the religion of his day. You whitewashed tombs. He used those words to describe the priests in the temple, not the prostitutes in the streets. In Isaiah chapter 51, verse 6, we read, "Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look upon the earth beneath, for the heavens shall vanish away like smoke, and the earth shall wax old like a garment, and they that dwell therein shall die in like manner. But my salvation shall be forever, and my righteousness shall not be abolished." Everything in the universe will pass away like wax, except my salvation and holiness. Now, universe has absolutes like speed of light, Planck's constant, or gravitational constant, but they are only temporary absolutes. Eternal absolutes are unique only to God. Atheists talk about evil, evil in this, evil in that, but how do they define evil? Where did they get their value system? Where did they get their absolutes values? What is the basis of their ethical system? You know, Greek gods gave no ethical system to the world which worshipped them, because you don't find holiness in Greek pantheon. Greek pantheon has no holiness. Greek gods and goddesses, they would sleep with anyone, anywhere, anytime. They would sleep with other gods and goddesses. They would sleep with human beings. They have no separation. They have no restrictions. But Isaiah talks about the Holy One of Israel. 24 times in this book, we find that. He is a holy God separated from his creation. My righteousness shall not be abolished. From his righteousness, we derive an ethical system. From his absolutes, we derive a value system. Now, atheists are living in a contradiction. They use a value system while denouncing the absolutes that could have come only from a holy God. Among all the attributes of God, his holiness scares most people, including Christians. What is the least desirable trait of God? If you take a poll, most people would choose the holiness of God. But you see, the holiness of God is not just another trait of God. It is the most important trait of God. It is the most important attribute of God. What separates the God of the Bible from the polytheism and pantheism is his holiness. Without holiness, God would become just another being, any other being in this universe. That's why Isaiah emphasized the holiness of God. His message is that we should search our hearts and deal with the corruption in our lives. In Isaiah chapter 1 and in chapter 33, he writes that a corrupt heart corrupts everything else. Then he talks about a God who speaks. Communication implies interest. A depressed person doesn't talk much. The book of Isaiah speaks about a God who speaks. He is interested in his creation. In chapter 40, verse 26, we read, "Lift up your eyes on high, and behold, who hath created these things, that bringeth out their hosts by number. He calleth them all by names, by the greatness of his might. For that he is strong in power, not one faileth. A God who calls every star by its name." Now we also give numbers and names to stars and planets, but can we remember them? But God gives them a name, and he knows every star and its location and its size and age. That is the awesome power and wisdom of God. He is a God who speaks. In Isaiah chapter 1, he is a God who calls his children like a father. In Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, we read, "Come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool." Isaiah describes a God who is calling people. A God who speaks to people. Atheists espouse a completely different worldview. There is no God. There are innumerable stars and we are stardust. The cosmos out there is cold and silent. We are alone. There is no voice of God. But Isaiah says in Isaiah chapter 40 verse 3, "The voice of him that cries in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." Atheist universe is cold, silent, and lonely. But the universe, portrayed by prophet Isaiah, has a voice of God preparing the way of the Lord. So why do atheists attack the book of Isaiah? Because it refutes their worldview at its core. It presents a God who is the creator of the universe. A God who rules the universe. A God who calls every star by its name. A God who calls human beings like a father. A God who is holy and merciful towards sinners. A God who speaks and communicates. A God who intervenes in history. A God who cares. A God who has a purpose. A God who inspires his children. A God who sent his son to die for our sins. A God who stepped into history. "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." Atheists do not like this God. That's why they attack the book of Isaiah. But if you see the evidences, you see how so many prophecies fulfilled in the person of Christ. And you see a beautiful plan of God in the book of Isaiah. A savior who came to this world to die for our sins on the cross and who rose again from the dead to give us the hope of eternal life. It is our prayer today that you put your faith in this savior and be saved. Thank you very much. Dear friends, our ministry is carried out through support from individuals like you. Please pray for our ministry, and if the Lord enable you, we ask you to support our ministry. Please visit our website www.drpaul.org. That is www.drpaul.org. Thank you very much. May God richly bless you.
Bye.